am Vaibhav Srivastav from Vaibhav E-Learning Academy. Today, we'll be discussing a new topic in biology, that is the cell. This is our part number one. So now, what cells are we going to talk about? So about today, we'll be discussing about the plant cell, not the animal cell. We also have many different kinds of cell, right? We have some plant cells, we have some animal cells. Animal cells are also divided into many different groups. So today we'll be not discussing about neither plant cells nor animal cells. We'll be discussing about the common cells. What are cells? So the first and foremost most important point is that it was discovered by Robert Hooke in 1665. So before starting a new topic, we always have some questions, right? First question, what is a cell? Second question, what are the components of cell? And third question is, how was the cell discovered? So in today's video, or in this video, we'll be discussing about the introduction to cells, what are cells, what are the types of cells, and we'll be discussing about the theory of cell. What is the cell theory? Cell theory is the theory on which the cell, how the cell was discovered. So this is what we'll be discussing in today's video. So let us start. So if you take an organism, for example, if you take a human being, you can compare that to as same as a book. So let me write down a sequence over here. If you take here a book. So as we all know, what is a book made up of? Books are made up of pages. Then, what are the pages made up of? Pages are made up of paragraphs. Then, if you know a paragraph, so what is a paragraph made up of? A paragraph is made up of a sentence. What is a sentence made up of? Sentence is made up of a word. And what is a word made up of? Letters. So you can see that this forms a system, or this forms a chain. So here in this chain, if you take these letters is the basic unit. Letters is the basic unit. A bunch or a group of letters form a word. A bunch or a group of words form sentence. Same, a group of sentences form paragraph. Group of paragraphs form a page, and a group of pages form a book. Now, if you take this example and apply to a human body, or if you apply to any body, you can see that the most basic unit of human body is not letters, cells. So as we all know that every organism, not only organism, every object in the world has something which is basic. Now, if you take a computer, for example, if you take a computer, you can see if you open a computer, there are many microchips, there are many RAM, a graphic card, many things combined to make the computer. Here, the computer we take in biology as an organ system or an organism. So like that. So for example, this thing was about a book. So now if you take your human, not really human, any organism, it is organism. Organism is the final product, you can see. The organisms are made up of many different organ systems. Organ systems, what are organ systems? As we know, there are many different organ systems in our body, starting from the brain, which is equals to nervous system. Then we have lymphatic system, and then we have circulatory, then a skeleton system, and then we have muscular system, reproductive system, circular system, digestive system, excretory system. We have so many systems in our body. So this is organ systems. Organ systems are made of organs. Organs are made up of tissues. And tissues are made up of cells. So you know, as this thing, if you take a human body, or if you take any organism, not a human body, cell is known as the basic unit. This is what you know, that cell is known as the basic unit. But there is also one more part, which is known as cytoplasm. Now, cytoplasm is actually a liquid comprising of water and some nutrients. No, not, you cannot say nutrients, it's like water and proteins. So a liquid comprising of water and proteins is known as cytoplasm. So if you state this part of cytoplasm, it goes in more detail. So cytoplasm, even in cytoplasm, we have many different parts in cytoplasm, which are also known as the parts of cells also. We'll be discussing the parts of cells, that is, what are the organs in the cells, or organelles, not organs. So like if you take a cell, so inside the cell also there are many organelles. So here in cells we have ribosomes, endoplasmic reticulum, or instead of endoplasmic reticulum we can actually say ER. ER is also comprised of SER and RER, smooth endoplasmic reticulum and rough endoplasmic reticulum. Then we have Golgi complex, or body. It can be either Golgi complex or Golgi body. Then we have nucleus. Then comprising it is known as nuclear membrane. Now if you go in more detail, you see that nucleus is also made up of chromosomes. Then it is made up of DNA. So these things are, if you go inside everything, you find that there are many simpler things inside any organism. So these are the details, like these are the more inside depth details, but we'll be discussing only till cells. So according to our point of view, cells is the basic unit of the life. Now, as we know the order, cells, a group of cells form tissues, a group of tissues forms organ, group of organs form organ system, group of organ system form organism. So if you, let us take a look at some of the basic things. Let us take a tissue, like if you see like a group of cells having functionally, a group of cells having functionally and structurally similar are known as tissues. A group of cells functionally and structurally, it means that its structure and its function both are similar. So only they can combine to form a tissue. Now, if you see a tissue, the same thing applies for the organ. A group of, instead of cells, we have here tissues. Group of tissues functionally and structurally similar are known as, instead of tissues, we have here organ. So let us take an example of an organ as kidney. A group of organs, for example, if we take kidney and then let us take like all the different organs, so if we are only taking example of kidney, they form an organ system which is known as excretory system. Now they also form, like they also have urinary bladder, urethra, uterus, they have all the different, so if we take urinary bladder, urethra, urinus, everything combines to form one system which is known as excretory system. So like these many organs are there inside our body, but here we are not going to discuss about any of the organ system tissues. We will be discussing about cells. So now we have understood that what is a cell. Cell is the basic unit of life. So you can see here the cell is the basic unit of life. Now, if you take cells, there are actually two types of cells. First type is known as animal cell. Second type is known as plant cell. Now, there are many differences also in the animal cells and plant cells. Like the animal cells have some organelles which plant cells do not have. Plant cells have some organelles which animal cells don't have. Like plant cells have chloroplast which animal cell does not have. And they have thylakoids, they have gynas. There are many things which animal cell does not have. And one more thing which is the very most important thing, the main thing is, wall. But plant cells have cellulose cell wall. So this is one of the most important point, that animal cells don't have cell wall. They only have a cell membrane. They don't have the wall. But plant cells do have the cell wall. So we'll be discussing about them in the like next videos or other videos. Then one more thing, animal cells are in circular, oval, or disc shaped, or also rod shaped. If you take circular, oval, or disc shape, I'm talking about RBCs. If you take like a rod shape, I'm talking about neurons. So neurons are like a rod shape, as you might know that a neuron has dendrites and then axon and nucleus also. So these are about rod shaped, but plant cells are hexagonal or pentagonal. So you know what is hexagonal, which has six sides, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So somewhat like this, this is like a plant cell. Or pentagonal is like, which is having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5 sides. So hexagonal and pentagonal, this is the shape of their cells. So this is the basic, which are the two types of cells, animal cells, plant cells. But if you take in common, both of them have almost the same different organelles inside the each cell. So now, as we have discussed about the types of cells, now we'll discuss types of organisms which have cells. Types of organisms which have cells. So basically there are three types of organisms. First are known as unicellular. So unicellular organisms, what are unicellular organisms? As we all know, uni is the meaning of one. So basically we can say that the organisms which have only one cell, the organisms which have only one cells are known as unicellular. So the organisms which have only one cell, cell are known as unicellular. So the examples are members of kingdom Monera and Protista. From our previous video, biological classifications, we have learned that the members of Monera and Protista are unicellular. Monera, let us take an example, bacteria. Protista, we can take an example, Euglena or Paramecium. So these are all the organisms which are unicellular. The organisms which have only one cell are known as unicellular organisms. Examples, members of kingdom Monera and Protista. So we can take examples as bacteria, Euglena or Paramecia. So this was about unicellular organisms. Now the second part is known as multicellular organisms. Multicellular organisms. So what are multicellular organisms? Now, as the name suggests, multicellular organisms mean the organisms which have multi-cells. So multi-cells, it means two or more than two cells. So the organisms which have two or more cells are known as unicellular organisms. So the organisms which have two or more cells are known as multicellular organisms. So here, now if I'm talking about two or more cells, it does not mean that the body only has cells. So as we have seen, like as we have discussed that cells, then we have tissues like that. So it means that the cells are in combining in some forms to make either tissues or organs. There are many animals, like phylums in animals, which are only of one cell, like they are unicellular. They are like porifers. Then we also have like tissues. Tissues are like cnidarians or cylindrates. So these are tissues organisms. But we can see that they have two or more cells. So it is known as multicellular organism. So in examples, we can write members or kingdom Animalia, Plantae and Fungi. But here, as we have discussed in the previous video, we have the exception yeast. Why? Because yeast is a unicellular fungi. So we can say that the members of kingdom Animalia, Plantae and Fungi, except yeast, like in fungi we have yeast which is unicellular fungi. So except those, we have the multicellular organisms. Animalia, we can take an example of humans. Plants, we can take an example of trees. And fungi, we can take an example of mushroom. So these are the multicellular organisms. The organisms which have two or more cells are known as multicellular organisms. Like we have to note that not only two or more cells are combining in the form of cells only. No. Cells which are structurally and functionally similar combine to form tissues, and that continues from tissues to organ system and then organism. This is about multicellular organisms. Then we have one more type, which is like actually a last type, but this type does not belong to what our main topic is. We have the types of organisms which have cells, but this one does not have cells. So this is known as acellular organisms. Now what are acellular organisms? So the organisms which do not have cell at all are known as acellular. Now here you might have the question, like we have seen that for unicellular we have Monera Protista. For multicellular, we have fungi, plantae and animalia. Then there is no kingdom remaining, right? So when we do not have any kingdom remaining for the multicellular organisms, for acellular organisms, then which organisms come under acellular? Here we have examples as virus, viroids and prions. So you might be confused, what is virus? Okay, we know virus. What are viroids and what are prions? So we will be learning this in our biological classification video. So as we move on from kingdom Monera to Protista, fungi, plantae and animalia, after that we have the last parts which are known as virus, viroids and prions. Viruses do not have cells, but they have their DNAs. So when they, like, you cannot say that viruses are living or non-living. Viruses are neither living nor non-living. They are non-living until they are free roaming in the air. But once they capture a host, or once they come in contact with a host, they become living, and like you can say in a term that they hijack the cell and they make the cell to produce the DNA of virus. So for example, if you take a cell and the virus has hijacked the cell, the cells are keep on producing the DNAs of virus. So once the cell is full of the virus DNAs, it cracks open, or you can say it is burst open. So when it bursts open, it transfers to the nearby cell, and the, again the process continues. This is what is known as an infection. So you can see what are infections, like when the virus comes inside a cell, it hijacks the cell and it makes the cell to produce its own DNA. When the cell is full of the virus DNA, it cracks open and the DNA is transferred to the other cell, which may cause infection. This is what about the acellular organisms are. The organisms which do not have cell at all are known as acellular organisms. Now, let us discuss about the cell theory. Let us see. So now, we will be discussing about the cell theory or the discovery of cell. You know, there is a very interesting story behind how the cell was discovered. We'll be studying this story now. So first and foremost, the main important thing again over here is who discovered this, like who gave the points for the cell theory. So if you take the normal point of cell theory has many different scientists going beyond that cell theory. Many different scientists are behind this cell theory. But the main and the first who started these all was Rudolf Virchow in 1858. So there are also like Scandias who started it in 1838, but the main theory was given by Rudolf. So he has given some 3 points. What are those 3 points? Let us see. First point: all the organisms are made up of one or more cells. All the organisms are made up of one or more cells. Like, can you agree with this point? There are some organisms, as I discussed, that are viruses, viroids and prions, which do not have any cell. They do not have any cell, right? So you can take this out, like at that time, at 1858 was a very old time. During that time, they didn't know much about viroids, prions and viruses. So If you take a point of view from that age, like if you take a point of view from 18th, then you will find that this statement is correct. Then, second part. Cell is the basic structural and, like, not organelle, you can't take a structural and organelle, like you can say the basic structural and functional part of an organism. Cell is the basic structural and functional part of an organism. Yeah, so we can, if you take at the time of 1800s, so you can see that, yeah, this statement is also correct regarding that time. And if you see the third and the last statement, which is actually a very famous statement given by Rudolf, that is, the cells always arise from pre-existing cells. So the cells always arise from the pre-existing cells. He has also given a name, that is omnis cellular, like not cellular, cellular, a cellular. So omnis cellular, a cellular. What is the meaning of this? So Rudolf had a statement that all the cells are arising, or they are getting, like all the cells are getting arised from a pre-existing cell, that there are already a cells, through that cells the new cells are being arised. This is one of the most famous statement given by Rudolf Virchow, or Virchow, you can say anything. So these are the 3 parts or 3 points. All the organisms are made up of one or more cells. This is the first point. Cell is the basic structural and functional unit or part of an organism. Then the cells always arise from pre-existing cells, that the statement given was omnicellula acellula. So this was the main theories which were given by Rudolph. Now there is not only the story, that this is not the story which I was talking about, there is actually a story behind all these three statements. So if you want to discuss about how these things were like developed, how the discovery of cell had come, we have to learn about what is a microscope. So you might be thinking in a biology topic how a physics topic is coming inside the microscope. But if you want to learn how the cell was formed, you have to learn about microscope. So microscope was invented by Zacharias Johnson. It was invented by Zacharias Johnson. He was an optic, he was dealing with the spectacles. So he was like an optics worker. He always had many glasses, lenses. So he worked with many glasses, lenses. So one day he took some two or three lenses. He joined them together and he was seeing something. So he found out that the combination of two or more lenses can be made into a new thing which was known as microscope. He was also like known to invent telescope. But if you look at the history, you can also see that Anton Leeuwenhoek, he and also Isaac Newton, and then many people, like there were not only one person who has invented the microscope. So we can say that even Isaac Newton, also Anton Leeuwenhoek, these people also Robert Hooke, the father of cell or the person who had discovered cell, even he had made some types of microscope. But the first thing was known by what we know is that thing. So then when the microscope was invented, it became very famous during that time because they got some new toy to play with. It was like all the naturalists and then biologists and zoologists, everybody was so keen to buy the new microscope and to use that. But if there was a person who was known as Anton Leeuwenhoek, so he was also interested in microscope, but he did not want to take the inventor's microscope. So what he did was he made his own microscope. So after making his own microscope, he was like very excited. So after making the microscope, he went out in the town and he was literally seeing each and everything. The roads, the stone, the trees, and even he had seen his teeth through his microscope. That is how, guys, the bacteria was invented. So that's what you might know, that Anton Leeuwenhoek only discovered bacteria. So what he was doing was he stood in front of his mirror, and then he took the microscope, he opened his teeth and he was seeing his teeth in the microscope. But you know why he got the bacteria? It is because during 1800s, people did not regularly brush their teeth. So the tidbits or the remaining things of the food were still in their mouth. So when he was looking at his own mouth, he found some small particles which he named it as animalcules. Let me write that down. Animalcules. He did not name them bacteria. Like he wanted to name them bacteria, but he had written, he had given the name animalcules. Why? Because they looked similar like animals only. So while he was discovering these things, he also used to send letters, like the letters to England, to an England botanist or like zoologist, England scientist known as Robert Hooke. So Robert Hooke, he would receive his receive Anton Leeuwenhoek's mails. He would read through all the points. He was very keen person, Robert Hooke. He was very keen. He used to study books. He took all the different books which written their emails, the normal mails, letters which he have sent. He studied, he named them cells. Okay, these things are okay, fine. But there are also two more scientists which were involved in the cell theory, which is known as M.J. Schleiden and Theodor Schliemann. Or you can say Schliemann. You can take the name of like that. So you can see that years 1838 and 1839. So let me tell you, M.J. Schleiden was actually a botanist. He loved to study the plants. So he had his own microscope. He used to see all kinds of, he used to study all kinds of plants. After so many couples of years, he had said one statement that all the plants are comprised of one thing which is similar in everything. Like in all the plans, there is one thing very common, and then he had revised what Robert Hooke had said, and they all tried to make an effort to make that, yeah, cells are not only found in animals, it is also found in plants also. Then what is this Theodor Schwann? So what he did was, he was a zoologist. So as you can see, the year difference is 38 and 39. So what he did was, through this one year, he took this Schleiden's point, and he was studying through all the points, and then he tried the same thing on the animals also. Like when he studied many different types of animals, like in the one year, he studied like almost hundreds, 200, thousands of organisms, like not organisms, animals, and then he concluded that the same thing also. For animals also. So then N.G. Schleiden and Theodor Schwann, they both like had the same, almost same theory, and then after that the three points came, then Anton Leeuwenhoek studied them, and then Robert Hooke finally, like the last person to study was Robert Hooke. He discovered many things. He was reading through the books, and he did so much hard work and effort, and then they finally found the word which is now known as cell. This was the final result for all these years of hard work. So this is what we were discussing today, that is the cell theory. What is a cell? The introduction to cell. Now there are also many different main points of cells, that is, what are the organelles of cell? This is the main topic of the video, or this is the main topic of the series which we have started. So this we'll be covering these in the part 2 video. And so I hope you have enjoyed this video. That's it for today, guys. So if you like the video, do sure to give it a thumbs up and like the video. Subscribe to this channel if you are new to this channel. Press the bell icon for more updated notifications. See you next time, guys. Thank you and goodbye.